Help me, Susie, or my might hurt my neck. That's about the right height for me is the sad part. Yeah, thank you. Was that not a powerful way to start worship? Exciting. Let's thank them again. So, well, I stayed in and listened to the choir. Can I tell you all something this morning? I have never been as excited to be in the pulpit as I am this morning, and it is good to be back. Good to be back. And I'm going to take a couple of minutes to tell you some things I didn't plan on saying, but we're talking about and participating in worship today, and we're talking about the community at worship. It's the capstone for everything we've been doing together over the past several months, since the first Sunday in January, talking about family and community. And we're going to worship today. We're going to talk about worship. We're going to worship. Our Sunday school lessons will be about worship. So let's just really enjoy it today, understanding that we're giving this to God. Isaiah, the sixth chapter, we find, I think, maybe, if you want to take time to read this sometime, Isaiah's commission as a prophet, as a preacher, maybe some of the strongest worship language there is anywhere. I want to read a little bit of it, and he dates it, but I want you to listen to this. Just hear the dating he gives it as when a man died and then what happens. He says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple, and above him were seraphims, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying." We have the same language in Revelation, we'll read it later. "And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And at the sound of their voices, the doorpost and threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke." And I want you to listen to what Isaiah says, because this is worship. This is a sinner coming into the presence of God. And I want you to understand today that this Lord's table right here, the body and blood of Christ, you and I are in the presence of God. That's what this gathering is all about. Every Sunday, we're in the presence of God. You got that? And listen to what Isaiah says. "Having seen this, 'Woe to me,' I cried, 'I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. I'm so evil, I'm so wicked, I'm so dirty, that even to come into the presence of God and worship tells me I'm nothing. I'm absolutely nothing." And then it says, "One of the seraphims flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongues from the altar." It's holy. "And with it he touched my mouth and said, 'See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin has been atoned for.' I'm ruined, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the Lord, the King Almighty." There's a verse in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, and the second verse, that I want you to hear this morning. 12:2. "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith." Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Lilius Trotter, lady. Her name is spelled L-I-L-I-A-S. She lived in the early 1900s, toward the mid-1900s. She was an artist, a musician, very well known, a writer, an author. But she spent 2 years of her life, in her own words, wrestling with God as to where God was calling her. And at the end of that 2 years, she succumbed to God. Now, I want you to listen to what this lady did. She spent 38 years as a missionary to the Muslim people in Algeria. I figured that this morning, just in my own mind, I think I did it right. That would mean she went in about 1976 and would be coming home today. in Algeria with no cell phones, no telephones at the time, no mail service, as a woman ministering to a missionary taking the gospel to the Muslims in Algeria. She wrote a pamphlet that impacted another lady from England named Helen Limmel. She was also an author and a very well-known musician at the time and concert pianist when that would have been considered rock star status. And it inspired her to write. I want you to hear what Lilias Trotter wrote in this pamphlet. Just listen to it real closely. I'm going to read it slow, and I paraphrase it a little bit. She said, "Never has it been so easy to live in half a dozen harmless worlds all at one time. I can live in the world of art, or I can live in the world of music or social science. I can live in the world of games and entertainment. I can live addicted to travel. I can live caught up in my work, and so on. And I found that between them we run the risk of drifting. And that which is good and joyful hides that which is best, which is God. Oh, it's easy to find where our lives are focused." And I would challenge all of you to listen now to what she said. Where do our thoughts lie when we are awake in the morning? What do you think about first? And where do our thoughts turn when the pressure is off during the day? What do we think about? Have it out with God and ask Him to show you whether or not all is focused on Christ and His glory. Have it out with God. Turn your soul's vision to Jesus. And it's hard to read this. Turn your soul's vision to Jesus and look at Him. And a strange dimness will come over all that is apart from Him. Listen to that again. Turn your soul's vision to Jesus. Look at Him. Not everything else. Look at Him right now. And a strange dimness will come over all that is apart from Him. Helen Limmel read that. She read Hebrews 12:2, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus." And she wrote these words. "Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace." Stand with us this morning.
And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Oh, so are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. things, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
God, our prayer this morning is that our worship is pleasing to You and not at all about us. God, because we come before You like Isaiah, as people who are ruined by sin, made filthy and made dirty. But God, You cleanse us, and we thank You for that. You allow us to sing to You, to praise You. You allow us to even say Your name, God. And we thank You. We praise You. God, help us to worship this morning as Jesus, Your Son, said, in spirit and in truth, in the reality of knowing who You are, in the reality, Father, of knowing where a family of believers has come together to raise our voices as one in unison, in hope, in joy, in humility, and in pain. Father, that Your name is lifted up. Father, we praise You that we can do this today. And we give praise to You that we can say together that from this moment on, it's not about me, but it's all about Jesus. We pray it together in Christ's name. All of God's people say it. Amen. Please be seated. Several years ago, the University of Tennessee won a national championship. A long time ago. And I was living in Florida at the time, and I got a care package that had a national championship hat and a shirt and a Knoxville News Sentinel and local paper and all my brother had sent me. And it was exciting to be away from East Tennessee. And they beat Florida State. That wasn't a bad place to live when that happened. And they had beat Florida. Oh, it was heaven. And I remember watching on TV a few days later, sometime after that national championship, they showed an official gathering or celebration that took place in Knoxville. The team came home to a huge welcome from the desert Southwest, and all of this was planned. And at that official ceremony, thousands of people attended, and they wore orange and white, and they painted their faces, you know, half orange, half white. A few of the players got up and spoke. I remember just watching it, and it wasn't long you realize it's good they can play football. They are not good speakers. It was terrible the way they spoke, and coaches got up and thanked the fans. And then you would see videos or an interview or two thrown in of a fan, and they're screaming and they're yelling and they're pumping their fists and their faces are painted and all that goes on. And we just, you know, literally almost we would say if you weren't part of it, they're making fools of themselves. And we saw it just in the last week or so at the University of Connecticut with the basketball celebrations and cars being overturned and fire set and people just going wild and making fools of themselves over their team winning. But if you notice or remember any of that, no one went away. No one went away from what happened when UT won that championship complaining about that celebration, saying the team didn't perform very well today. They were bad speakers. Nobody said that. And they hadn't even played football that day, what they were known for. But everybody came out excited. And what did they hope had happened? They hoped the team left knowing how much they were appreciated. People, that's worship. I hate to even use that example, but that's what worship is all about. That's what we're to do on Sunday morning, to say, thank You, God. Thank You, God. We as a family, we as a community adore You, God, for what You have done. And we've turned it around so often to say other things like, I don't like the music, or I didn't like that certain song, or I didn't like, you know, the preacher was really bad today. I know when I'm bad, and it happens. But that's not what worship is about. I want you to even think what the Scripture says about worship. I read that from Isaiah. That's serious stuff. It's serious stuff. And then the psalmist in Psalm 29:2 said, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory that is due His name, and worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness." Ascribe to the Lord the glory that is due His name, and worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. I want you to think about that for a minute. You see, there's something eternal that happens when we really turn our eyes to Jesus. There's something eternal that happens. I've always been amazed in a church setting. If you were up here this morning and could hear the singing of Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus and just overwhelmed by the emotion of, is that pleasing to God? They were singing, look at your son, and everything else. Did you grasp that, what that lady said? We can get caught up in so many different things, but they're good. But when we look at Jesus, everything else dims. It doesn't go away, it just dims. And we see what great is about. Not what good is, but what great is about. And there's something eternal that happens when we turn our eyes upon Jesus. There's something absolutely amazing that happens when Christians lift their voices together in worship to Jesus. Some people don't like to sing, and I understand that. Nowhere in the Scripture does it say, thou shalt have to sing or thou wilt burn in hell. But I think as Christians, we want to lift our voices together. And I'm going to challenge you to do something in a few minutes. And that is when we do some singing. And I think it'll be different than it's ever been for you. You'll be thinking what we're singing more today. But maybe if you don't like to sing, to just read the words. Because they're going to mean things today. But there's something eternal happens when we turn our eyes on Jesus and when we lift our voices and praise. But listen real close what I'm going to say next. Please, please listen. There is something cleansing, and that's the perfect word. We are a community, right? There's something cleansing about taking communion. There's something cleansing about taking communion and praying for forgiveness, praying for renewal when surrounded by other people that are doing the same. I've put on Facebook this week, how would you define worship, and got some fantastic people here in the church answering in different places around the country, some people I know, and I put the sentence on there, worship is, and just left it blank, and people just, it was great. I'd love to take the time to read them all. But one of them there that just struck me in its wisdom and its simplicity, is somebody in this church wrote, worship is vertical. It's about God. Not about me, not about you, not about what we like or don't like. It's about God. The communion is about God. The communion also has that horizontal part to it. I'm sitting in a room with my wife handling the body and blood of Christ. I'm sitting in the room with my aunt, with my cousin, handling the body and blood of Christ. I'm sitting in the room with a family that will live together forever, my brothers and sisters in Christ, handling the body and the blood of Christ. Can there be a greater act of worship? It's a time in which we pray for forgiveness. God, this week, I remember this. I did that. I'm a man of unclean lips. Will you cleanse me with the body and the blood of Christ. Doesn't need anything else but a recognition together in worship of what this is. We're going to distribute the body and blood of Christ now. Sam Widener, one of our leaders, a brother in Christ, all of us, will take us to God in prayer, asking His blessings on this time. David Johnson, one of our leaders, lover of Christ and lover of the body that is here, will prompt you to partake when everyone has been served. But let's recognize that around the Lord's table right now, we worship together. Let's receive it.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to Thee to thank You and praise You for this upcoming week that we have, in which time that we come back and remember this awful sacrifice that was given for each of us because we are sinners. Because of that sacrifice, we have our passport, our ticket into heaven. We could not do it by ourselves. We could not pay enough for it. Only Your Son's broken body is the ticket that's available. We ask Your blessing upon these emblems as we partake of them. Help us all to realize the impact of this service. Your Son's name we pray. Amen.
And likewise the cup, his blood poured out for the forgiveness of our sins.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, first of all, we want to thank you so much for all that you've given us. You've given us way more than we deserve, because we don't deserve any of it, Lord. And at this moment in our worship with you, Lord, that we take the time to give back what is really a small, small, small portion of what you've given us. As you'll guide us in using this money to direct your kingdom and to further your kingdom into the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let me ask you a simple question and hope for a response. Are you ready to worship?
Yes.
Listen to Psalm 42, 1 through 4. It says, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. I'm going to stop there. I remember hiking in the mountains of North Carolina, near Poplar, North Carolina, once with my Uncle Hoyle, and we were 4 or 5 miles into the mountain. We heard a pack of dogs screaming, barking. It was a horrible sound. And as we walked along the trail in a few minutes, as fate would have it, a deer ran by, a little low area. There was a little bit of water, and the deer ran by foaming at the mouth and his pack of dogs on its heels. I'm sure that deer wanted water, and it was horrible what was going to happen on up through the woods. Psalmist had seen that, and he says, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. And when can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night. Anybody here hurting? My tears have been my food day and night. And when men say to me all day long, where is your God? God is dead. When men say that to you all day long, these things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go with the multitude, leading the procession to the house of God with shouts of joy and thanksgiving among the festive throng. Verse 9 and 10, he says, I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Pleading. Why must I go about mourning and oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, sing to me all day long, where is your God? As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. Please stand. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. Desire, and I long to worship thee.
As a deer
panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are
I want to read, and if you want to be seated, please do. I want to read from Psalm 36, verses 5 and verse 7. It's the song book, the worship book of the Scripture. And this is one of the psalms that's written. It says it's to the director of music, from David himself. And I want you to listen to these verses. He says, "Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, and your justice like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve both man and beast." Doesn't hurt to read Scripture twice, does it? "Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, and your justice like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve both man and beast." Let's worship. If you wish to stand, but let's all worship together.
It's your love, O Lord, it reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain, yeah. Your justice flows like the ocean's tide. Let's lift our voices together, and I will lift my voice to worship you. Shadow of your wings, your love, O Lord, it reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, yeah. Your justice flows like the ocean tide, and I will lift my voice to worship you. Thank you.
reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the skies.
Amen.
God, there is nothing like singing your word to you. We know it's pure, and we know it's clean, and we know it's your word. And Father, thank you. Thank you that you let us sing it back to you in worship. All of God's people say it.
Amen.
Amen. Psalm 103:1. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to make this worship vertical and horizontal, not in a hokey way. If you're with family or friends or someone, you just say, "Dadgummit, I'm glad you're my brother or sister in Christ." Take their hand as we sing this song together. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. God, bless your holy name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh. worship your holy name.
Please be seated. I want to read to you a very powerful scripture. It's found in the book of Revelation, the fourth chapter. I want you to listen to it real close. Years ago, I was standing in the back of a church service and everyone was singing to the top of their voices. I can remember it like it yesterday, and singing as a deer panteth for the water. And a gentleman came in and he said, "What is this music all about? A deer panting for water?" And he said, "I don't like rock and roll music in church." You can imagine when I turned to the psalm and said, that was written by that great rock star, David. And there was a red face and there was repentance. And I mean that in a very kind way, a very respectful way. How often do we sing Scripture that maybe we don't realize we're singing Scripture? Can there be anything greater? I was thinking, preparing for today, how much you miss preaching when you can't preach. And I was thinking of the pain that I know some people in the church are going through in their marriages. Pain that maybe you're going through in your business. But we can take that to God as a deer that panteth for water and say, "God, my soul needs you. I need you." And there can be no greater worship. And then we get to come back and say, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." We get to give our worship back to Him. But I want you to listen to this scripture. Isaiah wrote it, and then John, there must be something to it. They saw the same thing. And I want you to listen what he says about the throne in heaven. A lot of this doesn't make sense to us. We describe it just like John, but it wouldn't make sense to us to hear it right now. Nobody here has ever seen a seraphim, have you, with six wings and covering eyes and feet? But listen, he just tells us what he sees. He says, "After this, I looked up, and there before me was a door standing open into heaven." I'm going to get to see it and tell everybody about it. "And the voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, 'Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' And at once I was in the Spirit." He's left. Apostle John, the only one to record this. "At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven, with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper, carnelian. A rainbow resembling an emerald encircled the throne." He's describing things we don't have language for, wasn't he? "And surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads," these leaders. "And from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder." He's seeing God, isn't he? "Before the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne, there's what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. And in the center around the throne, there were four living creatures. And they were covered with eyes in front and in back. And the first living creature was like a lion, and the second an ox, and the third had a face like a man, and the fourth was like a flying eagle." He's just describing it. Just picture it. "And each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under his wings. And day and night, they never stopped saying, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.'" Man, you look into heaven, and what are all of these creatures of God saying? What are they saying? It's in front of you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. Do you know if you go down in that chapter, it continues to describe, verse 11 says, Thou art worthy to receive honor and glory and power, for you have created all things, and by you will they came and have their being. You know that song? Thou art worthy. We're just singing scripture to God. Can there be a greater worship? It's vertical. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come.
Let's cry those words out together.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, my song shall rise to
This morning we began our worship with a celebration of Palm Sunday. The children came in with the palms and they waved them in celebration of Jesus coming. I want you to understand something as we close in our community worship this morning. When Jesus came to Jerusalem, he said, "It is time, let's go." And he went to present himself to die. The people came out and met him with those palms. Those palms were like flags. That's what it represented to them, flags of war. It'd be today like seeing the crowds in a hostile environment firing their AK-47s in the air. And they were there to greet Jesus that he might overthrow the Romans and install an earthly kingdom. The same crowd that waved those palms a few days later were crying out, "Crucify him." as they found out that wasn't what he was going to do. Now, what have we done as Christians? We've taken that ugly sight and turned it into an act of worship. Or as Isaiah said, I've got unclean lips. Will you make them clean? Will you take these lips that have cursed others, belittled man? Will you take these lips that have not acknowledged God, and with the heat of God's love and forgiveness, will you turn them into the lips of a prophet? People, when we worship, we throw our praise to God, asking that in return, he may be sometimes painfully changes us so that we go and become disciples, followers of his. We close every service, every Sunday morning, with a time of invitation for anyone who wants to publicly acknowledge Christ as their Savior, to come and to accept him, to be buried with him in baptism, whatever the decision, to clean our lips, to wash our feet that are dirty from sin, whatever analogy you want to use, to turn the palm leaves of war into palm leaves of adoration. In worship, he changes us. We'll sing a song, a closing song of invitation. If there be a decision, any public decision, I'd ask you to come this morning.
So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look for
announcement, but it covers four aspects of this week. One is our community dinner tonight here at 6 o'clock. The next is Wednesday evening, our regular Wednesday night programming, and Thursday, our special Good Friday program that begins at 8 o'clock. And please don't forget, over to the wall, Friday at 8 p.m. and over to the side wall, our prayer vigil sign up for this weekend. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for all of the things that we can be involved in here this week as we bring honor to you and we focus our lives and our hearts entirely on being together as your community in Christ Jesus and the joy that is ours, even through the suffering that Christ went through to make this week possible. Thank you that we were participants in praising you together today. Because, Father, in this way we have cut through all the images of eggs and candy, bunnies, baskets, so that we can see the Christ of Easter. Lord, today we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings. And I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings.
reaches to the sky.
I got one note. It's rubbing, and it's because of the chord progression I made.
Apparently.